Revathi ji, you are also, you know, insolvency professional. You are handling some matters as an RP.
Oh yes, sir, I am.
Okay.
I suppose that in front of your experience, it may not be too much because you are within IP. I am doing it as an individual, but I am also associated with two other RPs, assisting them in their work. Plus, I have my own and. I do the consultancy also.
Okay.
What about you, sir? How many cases your firm is handling?
See, in the CIRP, since beginning now, we have handled around 11-12.
Okay.
11, yeah. And there are 4-5 very active now. I mean, the resolution plans have been filed and pending for approval.
Okay. Audience, I just posted a query to you on WhatsApp. A. Raghunathan and Company. Generally, what is the size of the audience? How many people normally attend?
It will be close to 100, madam.
Okay. Yeah.
Expecting, let's see. Already they have registered.
Prashant sir, good morning. Good
morning, sir.
Good morning,
sir. Namaskar, Raju sir.
Yeah, namaskar. Yeah,
Tasneem ji, NVS Lakshmi Garu. Yes.
Yeah. Morning, President Garu.
Yeah. IBC is there. That's why I came in the response. One more speaker has to join. That's why we are waiting for her. My name is Sushil Ram Verma.
She is the main speaker today.
Yeah, yeah.
And also Mr. Raghu Babu Garu also.
Raghu has already joined.
Good afternoon, everyone. We will be soon starting in 2 minutes. We are just waiting for one of the speaker. I have been waiting for the last 20 minutes. I don't know why it is not connected. Anyway, good morning all.
Good morning.
Good morning to all of you.
Good morning.
Ask the president to deliver.
Good morning. President sir, can you please switch on the video?
Ramakanthji.
Revati madam, please switch on the video.
Yes.
Because for me it says the host has a disabled video.
Okay.
Thank you. Good morning. Good morning,
Sushila.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, Raghuji.
Yeah. Good morning. Very good morning.
Welcome, Sushila Ramji and
Thank you.
Yeah. I welcome all of you to this webinar on insolvency and bankruptcy code. Journey so far and recent developments. I welcome today's speakers, Mr. Sushila Ram Verma, advocate, the Indian lawyer and allied services, Delhi and Hyderabad. I welcome CS Raghu Babu Garu, insolvency professional, and I welcome CA Revati Raghunandan from Chennai, and our chairman, Sri President, our Ramakanth Inani Garu, President FAPSI, and our co-chair, Dr. Tasneem Sharif. And CBS Rajgaru, advisor, corporate laws and IBC committee of FTCCA, and the participants. I welcome all of you to this webinar to discuss the present scenarios and the latest development in the IBC Act and its consequences. Now I request our president, Sri Ramakanth Inani Garu, to give his welcome address.
Thank you, Lakshmi Garu. I extend my warm welcome to today's speakers, Ms. Sushila Ram Verma, Chief Legal Consultant, the Indian Lawyer and Allied Services, Delhi and Hyderabad, Mr. C.S. Raghu Babuji, IP and Managing Partner, ES Resolve LLP, Hyderabad, C.A. Revati Raghunathan, Partner A. Raghunathan and Co. Chartered Accountants, Chennai, Mr. V.S. Raju, former ROC of the AP and our past president, as well as the advisor of our corporate law committee, Mr. Naresh Galliji, chartered accountant and chair of our corporate law committee, Dr. Tasneem Sharif, co-chair, our corporate law committee and IBC committee, FTCCI, distinguished participants, IBC, that is the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, provides for a time-bound process to resolve insolvency, which applies to companies, partnerships, and individuals. Of course, the resolution against partnerships and individuals is yet to be notified. When a default in repayment above rupees 1 crore occurs, creditors can gain control over debtors' assets and can take decision to resolve insolvency. Under IBC, debtor and creditor both can start recovery proceedings against each other. IBC is a game changer, that is the creditors who were hitherto required to approach civil courts can now invoke the IBC. Previously, the threshold limit to invoke IBC was only 1 lakh only, which resulted in a large number of filing of cases. So the same has been increased to 1 crore rupees. The rules, the insolvency regime in India has recently witnessed significant changes to adapt to the dynamic and global scenario. IBC has been one of the most trending topics over since the inception, and with the latest amendments, new concepts have been introduced, such as prepackaged insolvency, separate insolvency process for MSMEs, assignment of NRRA, that is non-readily realizable assets, group insolvency, developments in going concern sale, etc. In this context, FTCCI is organizing this webinar on the journey so far and recent developments in the IBC regime, and for understanding the current position of law relating to insolvency in India. Our learned speakers will enlighten us on the constitutional validity of IBC 2016 and key amendments to the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016 and other processes. I am sure the deliberation will enrich our knowledge. Thank you.
Thank you, President.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, President Sri Ramakant Inani Garu. Now I request CA Nareshendra Gelli Garu, Chair, Corporate Laws and IBC Committee, to give his introductory remarks.
Naresh Garu, namaskaram.
Sir, namaste. Namaste, Ramakant sir. Good morning to the President of FTCCI, Sri Ramakant Inani ji, our advisor V.S. Raj Garu, co-chair Tasleem ji, office Lakshmi madam, and the speakers of the session, Mrs. Sushila Ram Verma, C.S. Raghubabu, and C.A. Revati Raghunathan, and to all the members who are participating for this webinar on the topic of IBC, journey so far and recent developments. Friends, I would welcome each one of you for this very important topic. And as President has broadly highlighted the objectives of IBC and the progress that has happened, I'm sure the speakers will take us through the latest developments that have taken place in last few months and few years, and also ensure that's a very interactive session, and the changes are far-reaching. I'm sure with such an eminent faculty and speakers who have a hands-on experience on the various cases of IBC, I'm sure the session would be very interesting. And I would now request Mr. Tasneem Sharif to please carry forward and continue with the program. Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone. So the first speaker we have, Mrs. Sushila Ram Verma. I'll read out her brief profile. She'll be taking us through the topic key legal provisions in corporate insolvency and judicial pronouncements. Madam is an expert legal professional having 25 years plus years of experience in handling multifarious legal work. Her expertise lies in advisory and transactional work and domestic and international arbitrations, cross-border dispute resolutions. She is the co-founder and chief consultant of Indian Lawyer and Allied Services, a multi-city business and commercial boutique law firm, having a pan-India presence. We welcome Sushila Ram, madam. Madam, the dais is for you.
Thank you. At the outset, namaste to all who are present. I take this opportunity to do a short introduction on the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. Now, let me just give a short introduction by informing the audience as to what was the law before the IBC came into play. Earlier, in India, we had 4 different types of laws that dealt with restructuring and insolvency matters. These were the Companies Act, the Sikh Industrial Companies Act, the SARFAESI, or the Securitization and Reconstruction of Financial Assets Act, and the Recovery of Debts Due to Banks and Financial Institutions. The presence of multiple laws, multiple forums, created a lot of complexities, and as such, it was felt that there should be one common law that would service companies, partnerships and individuals and deal with the issues across the board. Having this in mind, the legislature came up with the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, better known by its acronym, that is IBC. IBC sounds as easy as ABC, but sadly, this law is not so simple. It's extremely complex, and it has evolved. It has evolved and had changes several times in the last few years. The IBC, the object of the IBC is that it is a collective mechanism for resolution of insolvencies in the country, and it tries to strike a delicate balance for all stakeholders to preserve the economy and as such to preserve the corporate debtor, which is in problem. The primary focus of the legislation, which is deemed to be a beneficial legislation, is revival and continuation of a corporate debtor by either protecting the corporate debtor from its management, which has mismanaged the company, or from corporate debt by liquidation. And as such, resolution plans are welcomed to try and restore and restructure the corporate debtor. The Supreme Court has held that this IBC is deemed to be a beneficial legislation that has been enacted to consolidate and amend the laws relating to reorganization and insolvency resolution, and in order to ensure that resolution is done in a time-bound manner. This act was challenged when it first came out. And this challenge was has been dealt with in the judgment Swiss Ribbons versus Union of India. The judgment, the constitutional validity of the judgment was challenged on several grounds. Some of these grounds are that the differentiation between the corporate debtor and financial debtor strikes at the root of Article 14, which is right to equality, and as such cannot be upheld. Apart from that, the other challenges were that Section 29A of IBC, which deals with persons who are not eligible to be resolution applicants, is also not deemed to be constitutional. Another aspect was that the COC the Committee of Creditors was given too much of importance, and they had the power, if they had 90% voting, they had the power to reject a CIRP and withdraw the application. This the public felt was too much of power given to the COC. The matter, when it came up before the Supreme Court dealt with about 9 aspects when they dealt with the Swiss Ribbons judgment. They upheld the constitutional validity of the act. They upheld the fact that the distinction that was drawn between operational creditors and financial creditors did not strike Article 14, and as such, there was no bias caused by such distinction. They further directed that there would be 4 benches of NCLAT across India in order to enable parties to approach NCLATs that were closest to their workplace. And it also upheld the constitutional validity of Section 29A, which deals with persons who are not eligible to be resolution applicants. So all in all, once the IBC was upheld as constitutionally valid, and the judgment can be read in Swiss Ribbons versus Union of India, that is 2019 SEC, and the citation is given in the chat box. Now, some of the key amendments that have been there in the IBC since the pandemic. The first and probably the most important is that the threshold has increased from 1 lakh to 1 crore. This has obviously ousted several creditors, both financial and operational, from the purview of the act. But the government has taken this step in order to ensure that during the pandemic, they are able to protect corporate debtors who have run into difficulties. Additionally, there was a suspension of Section 7, 8, and 9 of the IBC, which allowed applications to be filed in the NCLT for a period of 1 year. So this, the period of 1 year, now when calculating limitation, the period of 1 year is deemed to have been suspended, and one gets a limitation of an extra 1 year because of the suspension period. Now, let me explain as to who can approach the IPC. A financial creditor or an operational creditor can approach the IPC if there is a default. Now, default would mean that it's a non-payment of a debt which was payable in part or in full and which the corporate debtor has failed to pay. So if you have a default, then you can certainly approach the NCLT. As a financial creditor, you have to have a strength of at least 10% of the financial creditors in the same class. And if you're an operational creditor, if you're a real estate allottee, you are now recognized as a financial creditor. But in order to file an application in the NCLT, you again need 10% of the total number of allottees when filing a matter in as a financial creditor in the NCLT. Now, an operational creditor may also, on the occurrence of default, issue a demand notice, and if the operational creditor has not paid his dues, then he can proceed after 10 days of the demand notice, he can proceed with an application for insolvency in the NCLT. The corporate debtor itself can also apply for insolvency under Section 10 of the IPC. Now, these are the three situations when an application for CIRP can be filed in the NCLT. Now, there are certain persons who are not entitled to file a CIRP proceedings under the IPC, and these are dealt with in Section 11 of the IPC, which is corporate debtor, which itself is undergoing a CIRP proceeding, or a corporate debtor who has completed CIRP 12 months prior to the making of the application, or a corporate debtor or a financial creditor who has violated terms of the resolution plan, or a corporate debtor against whom liquidation has been allowed. Now, the next thing that comes is the stage as to when such an application can be filed. The application can be filed when the debt becomes due. So if the debt has become due and a default has occurred, then the debt, in order to recover the debt, a financial creditor or an operational creditor can move the NCLT. Now, the process in the NCLT. The NCLT is supposed to have a quick process. They therefore call upon all documents that are required to prove that there was a debt and there has been a default to be filed before the NCLT. These would include commercial sales contract, invoices, correspondence, etc. Once the court is satisfied that yes, there has been a default, the chance is given to the corporate debtor to pay the dues. If the corporate debtor fails to pay the dues, then the matter gets admitted. Once the matter gets admitted, thereafter it is taken over by the committee of creditors, who then decide as to what should be the fate of the company. And applications are welcome for resolution of the company. One of the most important aspects of filing of an application in the NCLT is that there is a moratorium that is declared on all pending suits or executions, and any other, and there is a prohibition on transfer or encumbrance of any of the assets of the corporate debtor. Once this is done, all suits that have been filed against the corporate debtor are suspended up to such a time as the matter is decided by the committee of creditors. Now, once this is once the committee of creditors sits, then the matter is admitted in the NCLT, the IRP is appointed, who is later, of course, the RP, and he, along with the Committee of Creditors, takes the decisions as to how to move forward. I think I will just pause here because my part of the talk is only up to this part. I will only deal upon two other aspects, one of which is applicability of limitation. Now, the Limitation Act 1963 is also applicable to the IBC proceedings. The limitation period is 3 years from the date when the right to apply accrues. In case there is a delay in filing of the application, then an applicant can resort to Section 5 of the Limitation Act, which allows condemnation of delay in certain specified situations. Now, for computing the limitation period from 15/3/2020 till 14/March/2021, the Supreme Court has held in its order of 8/3/2021 that the said period will be excluded while counting limitation. And the limitation can also be extended if beyond 3 years, if the corporate debtor acknowledges that the debt is subsisting and that there is a liability for the corporate debtor to pay the said dues. In such a case, the Supreme Court has held in the judgment of Sheshnath and another versus Bedyabati Shirupali, the citation is given in the chat box, that in such a case, the limitation can be extended. Now, I would like to now deal on certain very important judgments that have been passed by the Supreme Court in matters relating to the IBC. In a judgment called Phoenix Arc Private Limited versus State Financial, it was held that the period of repayment of debt in any document in the absence of consideration of time value of money, which is essential in credit of a financial debt, the respondents who are financial creditors, if they are related parties, cannot be part of the Committee of Creditors. This judgment was passed with the objective that if one of the related parties was part of the Committee of Creditors, then they would not allow the Committee of Creditors to pass genuine decisions, and as such, this would be prejudicial to the operational as well as financial creditors. Another important judgment, which is Committee of Creditors of Amtec versus Dinkar Subramaniam. It was held that a resolution applicant who has not been able to fulfill the terms of a resolution plan cannot be deemed to have committed contempt of court, though it has failed to fulfill the terms of the resolution plan. Yet another important judgment was the Supreme Court's statutory bar on legal proceedings against the debtor during moratorium. The Supreme Court held that the moratorium period is a period in which the corporate debtor gets a fair chance to get back on its feet and try to get a resolution plan to get back to its operations. And as such, if there is a moratorium period is granted so that the company can continue to revive itself. But in a case, in this particular case, a section 138 and 141 under the Negotiable Instruments Act was filed. The Supreme Court held that as far as moratorium is concerned, the Negotiable Instruments Act, cases filed under the Negotiable Instruments Act are also suspended, though if there is an officer in charge and he is guilty of any lapse, then in such a case, an action can be taken against the officer per se, but not against the corporate debtor. Now, there has been a challenge regarding the powers of the Committee of Creditors on several occasions. One judgment which I had mentioned earlier was Swiss Ribbons, which is 2019. In a recent judgment in 2021, Kalpraj Dharmashi, versus Kotak Investment Advisors, the Supreme Court held that commercial decisions made by the Committee of Creditors is superior and cannot be deemed to be contrary to the provisions of IBC. The Supreme Court felt that if the COC passed any resolution or plan which was against the interests of the financial creditor or the operational creditor, the NCLT or the NCLET always had the option of striking off such a resolution. Finally, in another important matter, Arun Kumar Jagtarma versus Jindal Steel, the court held that promoters who were related parties to the corporate debtor were ineligible to propose compromise or arrangement during liquidation in a liquidation of a company. Some of the important amendments are Section 29A, which was introduced with retrospective effect from 23/11/2017. The provision lists out that persons who are ineligible to be resolution applicants, for instance, a person who is undischarged, insolvent, or a willful defaulter, he would not be entitled to be a resolution applicant. With this, I think I will let my co-speakers continue with the next part, which deals with what happens once an insolvency resolution professional is appointed. I would now like Raghu Babuji to please take over.
Yeah, thank you so much, Sushila Ram Madam, for taking us through the provisions of corporate insolvency and making application under Section 7, 9, 10, and also the judicial pronunciation. Please be on the call. We will be coming back to you with question and answers as well.
Sure.
Now, coming to the next speaker, Mr. Raghu Babu. He is by profession a company secretary, a law graduate, and an MPG MBA from ISP, and yes, also an insolvency professional. He is the co-founder for R&A Associates, which is a professional services engaged in corporate compliances. Mr. Raghu is also co-founder and strategic advisor for Samisti Legal LLP. It's a boutique corporate legal and transaction advisory services. And yes, Mr. Raghu is also a qualified insolvency professional and is the co-founder for EZ Resolve LLP. To add about Mr. Raghu, he is also a TEDx Glendale Academy. He spoke on TEDx in Glendale Academy. He is also a faculty for Indian School of Business. So Mr. Raghu will be taking us through key takeaways from insolvency resolutions and liquidation. Sir, dais is for you.
Thank you, Dr. Tasneem, for lovely introduction, and good morning to all of you. And thanks for the FTCCI giving me this opportunity. And me and my other co-panel members, will try and justify this session 2 hours on Saturday morning. I'll take around 20 minutes, and then I just want to give a couple of high level comments, and then I'll get into the topic. I mean, this law came in 2016, and since then, last 4-5 years, after the GST, this is the law which has transformed, continues to evolve. Government has taken so much of commitment to bring this law and implement the way government thought it. In terms of amendments and the IBBI and the regulator IBBI, as well as the Supreme Court, entire judiciary committed to implement this law, very well. And a lot of amendments have come in. First 1 year, 2 years, there was a lot of behavioral change in the corporate debtors that if I fail to discharge these liabilities, maybe I may be dragged to insolvency, whereby I will lose the management control. Never in the history of Indian, corporate or businesses, management went from a promoters and the old management to the new management. Even under the BIFR regime, management was continued to be with the same management. But the IBC brought in this huge change from a debtor's control to a creditor's control. This is what was the asked by the lenders, that there are some people who are not performing, but despite that, we are putting money and controlling them. That is where, you know, this whole thing came in. And that was one major, you know, fundamental change prior to IBC and after the IBC. Change in control from to the corporate debtors to the creditors. That's one. Second, the speed. I think entire objective was, speed is the mantra. When you say companies going through insolvency, there's a lot of stress, cash flow problem. So the definition of stress is defined from erosion of net worth to kind of cash flow test. Do you have a cash flow, enough money in the bank to pay to your creditors? If you don't have, then there is a problem. Let us fix it. So that is where it becomes very, very important how quickly we can fix this problem. There was another objective with which very, very time bound, the process has been laid down. These are the couple of things, basis which the law was introduced. And initially it was going great, in the ease of doing business ranking, just because of the IBC, we scored 40 additional points. These are all good things with which we have started. It was going great. But, again, last couple of years, because of the COVID, the problem got compounded. Even otherwise, I think there are, things started, kind of getting diluted in terms of the objective is concerned. Last week I was reading a coverage of, Financial Express, an article, which said, a good law, is a bad, is now we are having to say a bad implementation. This is one big comment. Second, whatever objectives we have set, in less than 4 years, I think somewhere it is getting delayed. As a corporate, as a professional, what we want, a easy, a simple law to implement and, follow. But somewhere I think there is everybody is concerned today. I think, is it getting derailed? I think we need to fix it before it gets completely derailed. Today is already the speed has come down. We went to maybe 60 kilometers per hour. Now maybe we are at 20, 30, kilometers per hour kind of a speed. I think this is one, big concern for, country, business community and everybody. I think maybe government should start addressing this. With that, high level comment, I just wanted to, share my experience. Particularly, my goal is to see once company gets admitted into insolvency, what all, it went through, the challenges and some of the takeaways. Over last, 4 years, me and my firm handled close to 15 matters at various stages. That gives me a decent amount of, experience and, competency to talk about the subject. So once company gets admitted, there are only limited outcomes. There are three outcomes. Outcome one, you could though company gets admitted into insolvency, you have an option to get out of insolvency, which is called settlement or a withdrawal. That's one outcome. Second is the resolution, means company is getting resolved to get out of the insolvency. That's the second outcome. The third outcome is the liquidation, because I am not able to resolve this company to get out of the insolvency, then it has to go to a liquidation. These are the three outcomes. The first outcome, which did not exist when the law was introduced, quickly government realized that there may be cases, which are not fit to be insolvent, go through the CIRP. Therefore, there should be a withdrawal mechanism, which has been introduced, and an applicant who files the insolvency application, coupled with a 90% of the COC approval, the company can come out of the insolvency. Good amendment. This is working very well. Now, you all must have seen, OYO, one of the OYO subsidiaries got admitted into insolvency a couple of days back. Maybe management did not pay attention to this. Company like that allowed the company, one of the subsidiaries to get into insolvency. Doesn't speak good about them, but they went quickly to NCLAT, I think yesterday or day before, there was an order, withdrawing this company from the insolvency. So that is one outcome, which is very well available. One is the withdrawal. A lot of cases, after admission also came out of the insolvency through the settlement mechanism. Now, the second important piece, corporate insolvency resolution process, AIRP, that is the main objective. So let us look at few milestones in this AIRP process. Now, I wanted to give a flavor, what happens, from the admission to the resolution. This new professional called insolvency professional came in, and initially it's called IRP. Once COC gets formed, you know, COC, Committee of Creditors, he is having, you know, power to either to continue IRP as an RP or appoint somebody as the RP concerned. So IRP/RP runs the process, entire the resolution process along with the COC. COC consists of the financial creditors, you know, whether they are secured or unsecured, somebody who has given a money to the company, they all considered as the financial creditors. So you have resolution professional who has been given a huge responsibility to resolve the company. And obviously there are certain powers given to the creditors, financial creditors. I mean, you have operational creditors and you have, you know, financial creditors, but idea was operational creditors. I mean, the government thought, you know, they are more smarter people who are managing the money, others' money. Therefore, let us give certain powers to them so that there is a balancing act, not that, you know, RP takes all the shots. That's how the COC came into place. Now, what happens as the, you know, NCLT passes an order admitting company to insolvency, there are few things which happens. As I said, one, IRP gets appointed. Second, there is a moratorium. There is a moratorium on certain actions against the company. As we all know, the company is under tremendous stress and, you know, needs a quick and deep surgery, you know, deep intervention is required. Therefore, if your people are start troubling this corporate, obviously they cannot survive. Therefore, there has to be a kind of a status quo on certain actions, like any recovery proceedings should be completely stalled once the CIRP gets, you know, the company gets admitted. That's one action. Second, obviously even the surface action, you know, gets stalled, you know, as is various basis. If the case is filed, it's pending till the company comes out of the insolvency. Like that, there are a couple of moratoriums. Moratorium is given to the corporate debtor. Besides this, there is also, idea is, you know, corporate debtor should be a going concern, protect the assets, continue the business so that there is value protection happens. And when the new buyer comes and takes over, there is a value is protected. Somebody can build on it and move on. Not that, you know, it is allowed to die or the value is getting deteriorated. Value protection, going concern is very, very important. Therefore, this moratorium was brought in. Also, law has provided few more, protections in the moratorium. Now the business are, in a bunch of contracts, right? You have supply contracts, customer contract, so many things. Just because company, you know, got into insolvency, you know, if all these stakeholders, you know, cuts off their relationship, obviously company, you know, cannot survive. You know, you have a critical raw material supplier or your customer, like, you know, you have a lot of power companies, you know, the state electricity boards, you know, power purchasing contracts or supply contracts. So government also ensured that those supply contracts, customer contracts and supply contracts cannot be terminated, which are critical to the business. I mean, this also has evolved. Initially, there was no clarity, but today is absolutely clarity. But there is a responsibility on the resolution professional during the CIRP period. Whatever resources you are using, you need to pay. There is a responsibility, not that you just, you know, extracting resources from, you know, suppliers and you don't pay. For CIRP period, the resolution professional is, you have to discharge all those liabilities, but the protection is provided. That is the moratorium is concerned. Now the second very, very important pillar, you know, in the IBC structure is the COC. As I said, you know, COC constitutes the financial creditors, not necessarily a secured financial creditors. They could be unsecured, you know, various kinds. Somebody who has given money, partly, you know, they are considered as a financial creditors. They constitute the COC. I mean, the resolution professional has to constitute the COC. Now, I mean, before this, there is a claim, you know, a collection of claims from the various stakeholders. As an IRP, though there is a moratorium against the company, but it is not against the individuals. So the check bounce courses against the individuals, they continue. Company will be discharged after, you know, the resolution plan is approved.
And this way, madam, please tell.
So in this particular case, there's a Supreme Court judgment of 2021, which is Mohan Raj and others versus Shah Brothers, in which the court has held that yes, the company will not be liable, but the management, if they are responsible for the check bouncing, they would be liable. So the moratorium applies even for check bouncing cases.
Even 138 has been amended, 138 negotiable instrument has been amended. Even yes. If the case are there, they can withdraw and settle the matter. 138 also has been amended to the next stage. on that date of the negotiable instrument act.
Yes, sir.
The moratorium is anyway not applicable for any criminal proceedings.
Yes, sir. Next question. How's the priority decided between the various creditors during the resolution? I think this waterfall. Mr. Raghu, you can take this.
I also covered in my talk. I mean, the section 53 talks about the how the monies will be distributed in the case of liquidation, but in the resolution there is no explicit provision. But definitely the whatever the 53 talks about, that needs to be followed. Only then the stakeholders will be interested. But there are certain peculiar cases where you may have a secured lender who has a 10% stake in COC, whereas an unsecured lender who has a 90% stake. So with the unsecured lender having 90% stake, he may be able to influence the resolution in his favor because the secured lender is only holding the 10%. These are the exception, but otherwise what is settled law is earlier initially it was thought you need to follow 53 or you need to take care of the creditors' interest uniformly, but what the Supreme Court has decided, different category of creditors can be dealt differently. Same cause has to be dealt in the similar way. All second charge holders should be dealt same way. All secured creditors should be dealt same way. All unsecured should be dealt same way. So you cannot give a priority to one unsecured lender, operational creditor, and disregard the other one, like that.
As well to add, earlier 1956 Act very clearly states 539, because employees, the dues to the employers and workers first, then afterwards government dues, then the secured creditors and unsecured. That was the actually the 1956 Act 533, 539, it says like that. It's a corresponding section has been given 52, 53, as you rightly point out, you have to see.
Just to add further, generally you have a term lending institution and working capital, lenders. Working capital lenders, their primary charge is on the working capital assets and the second charge on the fixed assets. Most of the cases, you don't have any working capital assets, only the fixed assets. Even in the normal scenario also, there is a understanding whenever fixed assets are realized, generally 80% goes to the term lending institution, 80% goes to the working capital lenders. So that is what is also followed in the in the resolution as an agreement between the various secured lenders. Mostly they're all public financial commercial and all that.
Yes, madam. Yes,
and
thank you so much. Next question. For CIRP, is it only the base resolution plan which is going to be considered, or RA will be invited like CIRP? Sushila madam, you want to answer on this?
I think I'll let the IP professionals answer this. Maybe Madam Revati can answer this.
I think the question is regarding this pre-pack resolution plan. The priority will be given to the base resolution plan, which is prepared by the management themselves. But if it is not acceptable or it is not going through because of any reason, then the RA will invite other resolution applicants, and it will be generally through a Swiss challenge kind of a method, where a Swiss challenge is the promoter is then asked to match the resolution plans which have been received on the basis of the RP's invitation. So this is how it will proceed.
Thank you, madam. We'll move on to the next question. If the corporate creditor doesn't get the details of the process of by the RP, then how to proceed? So anyone want to take this?
Well, you can make an application in the before the NCLT. That's the only way out. But there is a Supreme Court case which says that operational creditors also have a right to know what is going on in the COC. And they should not be completely ignored. If there is some information that has to be shared and they ask for it, that information should be given. They may not have voting rights, but they have a right to information.
They have to move an application and involve the IRP also as one of the parties to the process.
Yes, that's also there. I did it very recently in NCLT. Yeah, I was having some difficulties. Yes.
Prabhu might be knowing.
And I mean, generally, you know, as an RP, you know, you need take, you know, every stakeholder into confidence, engage with them, share the information, all that happens. But sometimes RP hands also very tight, you know, where lack of cooperation from the CEO and, you know, the employees. There are, you know, difficult situations also where RP is going through.
Yes, but if you're the largest operational creditor, then you should be considered. Then you cannot. In fact, they told me go to NCLT and get an order. So I went and got the order.
IRP job is very, very difficult job. We were facing earlier with the liquidator. Liquidator, because so many people write to the liquidator when to go to liquidation, to answer them is very, very difficult. Now the IRP is very, very, to face all these things is very tremendous and very task. That is what my experience is.
I was just going to suggest, sir, one of the IPs, please throw some light on liquidation as a going concern, because that's an important aspect which we have not really dealt with.
Yeah.
Will one of you just...
Revati ji, you want to go on? You can please share.
Liquidation as a going concern, I would say that, you know, the liquidator will first take the opportunity to go through Section 230 of the Companies Act. They'll try for some compromise and arrangement, and if that fails, they will move on to liquidation. So liquidation as a, you know what, my own perception of this is that all avenues have failed during CIRP. That's why liquidation is ordered.
Yeah.
But as a going concern, courts are giving you an opportunity to go through this Section 230. But 230, if it goes through, fine.
Yeah,
but if it does not go through, it is straight away a liquidation. That is it. You've already written the death sentence by giving the liquidation. But after that, revival is right through the Section 230. And if that is not going through, then it is the entire process of liquidation would go through. That is my perception. I don't know if sir will have any other opinion on it.
Any possibility is there for compromise arrangement as required on Section 230 of the 213 Act.
Yes.
That is what, what they will not take there once it goes.
The NCLTs and NCLATs are, you know, I mean, the whole judiciary trying to say that, you know, the going concern continues, there is no liquidation.
Yeah.
I mean, even during the liquidation, let us give one more opportunity. I think that,
yes,
is, you know, it is happening. But the beauty here is, I mean, you know, sometimes initially it didn't sink to us, you know, liquidation and then going concern. The same legal entity is continuing. Our liabilities are, you know, shaved off. So clean slate and same company. You know, assets are there and track record is there. That way also it is a very good model. I mean, hybrid evolved, you know, companies are dying. You know, only the liabilities are dying and the bad is going up, but the assets and the track record is coming. I mean, that way, I think there are few good cases which have come through you know, concern same. Yeah.
Then as well, as and when you file the before NCLT, the honorable member, they say, why don't you settle all these things? Why you are going?
Yes, exactly, sir. Exactly.
That's what you are facing it. Then we will ask the parties, "Hey, Baba, why don't you settle? It's only less than 1 crore you have filed it." But earlier, before this announcement of that 1 crore, so many people, so many applications are pending there, less than 1 crore. That's why Raghu is very, very...
Yeah, thank you so much. Coming to the next question, can someone throw light on the Limitation Act applicability? If it is applicable, how is it applicable?
Sushila Ram.